In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Good evening once again. You see, this chapter is a little long, so that's why we had to split it into two parts. I hope you've seen part one. From part one, now we move to part two, the second part. Yeah? Well, I'm happy that this Bible class is coming in as useful to many of you. And many of you have poured in your comments. Thank you very much. We come now to, of course, verses 17 to 20. You know, Matthew was writing for the Jews, and writing for the Jews meant that the Old Testament was sacrosanct. You know, it could not be just trashed, it had to be respected. And Matthew makes sure that to convey to his readers, who are the Jews, that Jesus truly honored the Old Testament. So whatever Jesus said, he's recorded it. So we shall start reading into it. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth disappear, not the smallest letter, not the least stroke of a pen will by any means disappear from the law until everything is accomplished. So the law was sacrosanct. It was holy. And Jesus says, not a single smallest letter, you know, will disappear, should disappear from it. And yet, you remember when we were doing the basic Bible study courses, that is 1 to 9, I told you how our current Bibles have omitted some verses. You remember? They write empty over there. And I told you the reason. So that reason was valid. It still honors what Jesus said. But those verses have been omitted for a rightful reason. Yeah? You can watch those videos. Right? We can't spend time on that now. Yeah? Because then it will take away from the time that we have to invest in Matthew chapter 5, the Sermon on the Mount. Yeah? So let us come into this. So what Jesus is saying is, and what Matthew is writing is, that Jesus came to fulfill the law. We go next to verse 19. Therefore, anyone who sets aside any of the least of these commands and teaches others accordingly will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever practices and teaches these commands will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven. So Jesus honors the law, but the Pharisees were constantly, you know, accusing Jesus of not respecting the law. And so Jesus says this very, very strong condemnation of the Pharisees. He says that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the scribes, you will not enter the kingdom. And let me tell you something. You know, I had been to Disneyland in Tokyo many years ago, I think 1994 or something. And there, you know, it was fascinating standing in those queues, yeah. And there were long serpentine queues everywhere for every ride, for everything. It was so exciting. But the point was, you know, there were some rides that were not for children, yeah, below the age of, say, 10 or whatever, yeah. So, you know, they used to put up a guidepost with a marker, you know, with a projectile. So any kid who could pass through was not allowed. So he had to get out of line. He was not allowed. That was the mark, you know. That was the mark at which, if he was lesser than that, he couldn't. He couldn't go for the ride. Same way, what Jesus says is, you want to go to heaven? Make sure that your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the scribes. It was an awesome statement to make, because the Pharisees themselves were telling the Jews that because we are children of Moses, all of us will be going to heaven. The Pharisees thought Jesus was against their laws, so because, you know why they thought that they thought Jesus was against the law? Because they found that he was not observing the Sabbath. I have told you, he was observing the Sabbath. If he was healing on the Sabbath, it's because he used to go to the synagogues on a Sabbath, and every Jew would in his locality would go to the synagogue on the Sabbath for the service. And so would all the beggars and the mendicants and all those who were diseased and sick would come there for alms and begging. The widows would be there. And Jesus would look at them and have mercy on them. For that is why he had come. That was his mission. He was the Messiah. And so he would heal them on the Sabbath. He was not healing them to tease the Pharisees or the scribes. He was healing them out of love for those people who would come on a Sabbath. Other than the Sabbath, you know, people would probably not go in those droves, you know, to the synagogues. So like you go for Sunday Mass, you can see the church all full on Sundays. And you can see some mendicants and beggars out standing outside begging, you know, for almsgiving. So Jesus was not disrespecting the law. It was the Pharisees who were thinking like this, with their contorted minds. Yeah. They also found that his disciples did not observe the ceremonial washing. The washing of the hands, you know, the ablutions, they call it. Yeah, even though if you go outside the masjid, you will see them, you know. And because in those days there was less water, they had this ritual. I think I'll explain it to you some other time. They found that they were not. But what Jesus said, what goes inside your mouth is not important than what comes out of it. No, he says that. So was Jesus against the law? Absolutely not. He said even a small tittle, you know, that thing, that accent that you have over characters sometimes, should not be taken away from it. What Jesus wanted was a righteousness that was beyond that of the scribes and the Pharisees. No hypocrisy. When you want to follow God, there cannot be hypocrisy, for God can see your soul. The Pharisees had their own laws. They had made their own laws from one commandment, which is from the 10 commandments, they had made 63 tractates. And hundreds of stupid, arcane laws that actually burdened all the people. So Jesus said anyone who was better than the Pharisees would not go to heaven. What he said to the Pharisee was shocking, of course. So please watch the video on scribes and Pharisees, you know, I have the earlier video, to understand this in greater detail. Yeah, about scribes, Pharisees, Sadducees, yeah. A standard of righteousness, which was very startling to the Jews of those days. The Pharisaic law was a law in letter. It was not in spirit. It was not in spirit. You'll see in Matthew chapter 7 verse 12, I will explain this to you in great detail. I will explain it to you in such a way that it will touch your heart. The Pharisaic law was more in letter, but not in spirit. You know, but Jesus was laying a startling standard. What Jesus is telling is following the law in spirit. For example, you know, you go to church and on an evening you go to the chapel and you come out and go into the compound. There you find a purse. You pick up the purse and you say, Hare, whose purse is this? Whose purse is this? And you look around. Nobody is answering. Now, since nobody is answering, you keep the purse in your pocket and you walk away and you take all the money. You might say that you didn't steal it. In letter, the law in the letter does not say that you stole it. But in spirit, you have. You could have easily gone and given it to the parish priest or the sacristan, counted the money and tell them, here it is, this belongs to so and so. Or you would have opened the purse, found out the name of the person, gone to his house and given it to him. So there's a following. We can follow the law in letter and we can follow the law in spirit. You know, also one more thing is, following the law in spirit is what we call self-esteem. You know, when, you know, we can cheat the world, we cannot cheat God, and we cannot cheat ourselves. I remember years ago, I used to go and train at the naval headquarters, you know, at Naval Dockyard. I used to train the naval officers and the army and the others. So I had to reach Bangor at 9 o'clock, and I had a rule, you know, where anybody coming late after 9, reaching the hall, you know, the training hall after 9, would be punished. And how? He would have to sing a song. Now, having been so strict on this rule, because, and anyway, they never used to break the rule because they were more disciplined, you know. So I had to make sure I was on time to reach the training hall. I was before time. Of course, everything would be set up and made ready by the staff. So one day I was late, and I knew if I went by taxi, it took me 30 minutes. Even if the taxi driver drove very fast from Wadala to a museum at Naval Dockyard, I wouldn't reach. The only faster way to go would be to go to Dadar, Central Railway, and take a train, 11 minutes fast train, VT. From there, take a taxi and then bang, I'd be there. It was already 8:30. So I rushed off to the, I took a taxi and I went to the Dadar station. And in those days, they had these coupons, you know, you had to insert the coupons and dot matrix printer would print out the date and time. So I paid the taxi guy and I ran off, you know, and just at the entrance is platform number 6, where the fast trains to VT come along. And as I ran into the lobby of that place, there are all these vending machines, you know. I'd taken out my coupon in the taxi itself to save time. And there was a train chugging along, a fast train came in. I rushed and put this coupon inside the coupon machine. And it made that sound. I took it out, put it in my pocket, and I ran and caught the running train because I had to catch it. Of course, I reached on time. When I reached there, I was thinking that morning, how do I explain self-esteem to them, to these people, these naval guys? How do I explain the concept of what exactly is self-esteem in a simple story? I was thinking about it and I prayed to God, God help me explain it to them. You know, when I sat in the train, I was happy that I got the train. But when the train reached Baikala, I put my hands into my pocket, took out the coupon and saw. You know, normally the imprint would come on the backside of the ticket coupon. I looked at the coupon, it was blank. The dot matrix printer had run out of ink. I should have gone to another coupon machine, but I didn't in that hurry. Now that ticket, that coupon looked as if it was not used. I was wondering, now at VT there are so many TCs who stand there, they will catch me. But since I was not guilty, I think I forgot about it. And I walked right through the maze of all those TCs, you know, at VT between the local and the outstation trains, there's a passage, you know. There are all these TC stands. I just walked through them without even remembering. I went and was giving the class, and when this topic of self-esteem came in, I remembered that coupon. So I took out the coupon and I told them, see, this so and so happened. And I gave them the coupon. I said, tell me if this coupon, I can use it. They looked at the coupon. I said, yeah, of course, you can use it. It's not used. Then I told them the story, what happened to me in the morning. And then I asked them, should I use this coupon again? Can I use this? Will I be cheating the railways? Some said yes, some said no. But I said, would I be cheating myself? They said, yes, you will be cheating yourself. That is keeping the law and spirit. That is keeping the law and spirit, where you don't have to prove yourself to anybody except to God. because God knows. You might fool the world, but you can't fool God. Yeah? So Jesus was asking the Pharisees to follow the law in spirit, not in letter. Next, verse 21 about murder. Now look, this is brilliant. This is totally brilliant, murder. Now look, you have heard that it was said to the people long ago, you shalt not murder, and anyone who murders will be subject to judgment. In the Old Testament, it is written, do not kill, no? One of the commandments. But I tell you that anyone who is angry with a brother or sister will be subject to judgment. Again, anyone who says to a brother or sister, Raka, is answerable to the court, and anyone who says, you fool, will be in danger of the fire of hell. Huh? Why is Jesus saying this? Why is he condemning a man who has not murdered? Why is he condemning a man who just got angry and he uttered the word Raka? Actually, is a term of contempt, you know, in Jewish, you know, like, you fool, something like that, no? Jesus condemning a man for that? And you wonder, why is Jesus so harsh? No, there is a reason. There is a reason. You know, they say in Hindi, Har cheez ki shuruaat ek khayal se hoti hai. Everything in this world, in this universe has started with the thought. First the thought occurs in your mind, then you are led into action. From one small spark, the fire engulfs the entire forest and burns it to cinders. I will tell you. You begin with the Raka. That guy whom you've cursed or cussed, he's going to keep it against you. Yeah? He's going to keep it against you. Wait, I'll come back to that. Let's read the next verse. Therefore, if you're offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First, go and be reconciled to them, and then come and offer your gift. My word, this is brilliant. Jesus doesn't say that if you are offering a gift at the altar and you remember that you are a sinner, then go back. No, he says that even if you are not a sinner, if you are offering your gift at the altar and there you remember that your brother or sister has something against you, go back, leave your gift, go back. Go and get reconciled with them. Then come and offer your gift. I'll tell you why. There's a story I used to tell even the lower ranks among in the Navy. You know, generally a lot of Maharashtrians would be there. So I made up a story. I think I need to tell you that story. Because we make those mistakes very often. Very often we make those mistakes. You know, there is a man, there's a couple. They are lower middle class. The man is a casual worker in a company. He works very hard. His salary is the wages he gets is only enough for a hand-to-mouth existence. His wife also has to work. Yeah, she works in a government thing, but they have these children and they have to tend to them, so the money is never enough. Tomorrow is his wife's birthday and he remembers that I have never given my wife any present so far. So many years of our married life, I never could afford to give her a present. Then he makes up his mind with firm determination. He says, definitely next birthday, I'm going to give her a Mangal Sutra. I know it might cost a bit. Maybe I'll get only two tolas or maybe 2.5 tolas for 1 lakh rupees. But I will save 1 lakh rupees. This entire year I'm going to work hard. Makes up his mind. And from that day onwards, he starts working another job without telling his wife. He says, work is, there's a lot of work, so I have to keep on working. So he does two jobs, doesn't tell his wife. And he keeps on saving money, works extremely hard with that single-mindedness of purpose that I have to buy my wife a Mangalsutra. 11 months have passed and he's already got more than 1 lakh rupees in savings, which his wife doesn't know. Her birthday is now coming on. He goes to the jewelers, selects a good design and says, I want this 2 days before a birthday, whatever. And he pays the money and he takes the thing and he hides it at home. On the evening before a birthday, he comes to her with his hands behind his back. His hands are holding the jewelry box. Now you get those jewelry boxes from the jewelers that contains the Mangalsutra. And he says, happy birthday, and he shows it to her. She looks at it, she can't believe. She looks at the box and she is surprised. And he says, happy birthday. She opens it and she sees the Mangalsutra. Aya, Naveen Mangalsutra. And he says, yeah, I bought it for you. That is why you were working hard and coming late every day for the last 1 year. He smiles, the husband smiles sheepishly. She's so happy and over the moon. She goes to the bathroom cabinet, takes out the bottle of oil, coconut oil. She oils her hair. She intends to have a shampoo tomorrow. She takes out the best sari, the paithani. And she looks at it and she ponders, what will look best with this Mangalsutra? She puts it against the chest and feels the Mangalsutra. She selects one paithani that looks appropriate for a birthday. She has to go to work tomorrow. She's going to wear it. And she has to go by train. So what does she do? She keeps everything and she's happy on cloud nine. She's so happy. The following morning, the husband wishes her again. And then he goes to work. The wife gets ready to go to work. The children have already been sent to school. She shampoos and she has a wonderful bath and she comes out fresh and she wears her clothes and she wears her paithani. She looks very nice in Maharashtra attire. Finally, she takes the Mangalsutra and puts it on. And she looks at herself. She feels an immense pride, not at the Mangalsutra, at the love that her husband has for her. She puts it. And now, before leaving the house, she covers the Mangalsutra with a pallu because she doesn't want to get robbed in the train. She covers it and she reaches her office by train. Before opening the door and entering the office, she takes the Mangalsutra out of the pallu so that it can be seen in plain sight. She feels so proud and happy. It's her birthday. She opens the door and she comes in. As she walks, even her walk has changed. She's floating. She's as if she's walking on clouds. She's so happy. All the women look at her and she looks. Then they find her looking very stunning. And then that Mangalsutra is twinkling. Suddenly one of the ladies gets up from her typewriter. And she comes running towards her. Yeah, Naveen Mangalsutra. Says, yeah. Kiti tolyacha hai? How many grams is it? She says, don tolyacha hai. Don tolyacha hai? Maza bagh na? Daha tolyacha. Look at mine. Much bigger than yours. How will the lady feel? How will the birthday girl feel? You know, many times we do the same thing. And then we wonder, why is that other person not talking to us? Why is that other person not talking to us? We don't even realize that we are offending people left, right and center every day. Being unaware. That's why Jesus is saying this. Therefore, if you're offering your gift at the altar, there remember that your brother or sister has something against you. Leave your gift there in front of the altar. First go and be reconciled to them. Then come and offer your gift. We do the same thing every time. I'll tell you when you're doing it. You know, we have this thing in India. No? When any child passes the board exams, you know, the matriculation, the parents will buy a lot of sweets, you know, box of sweets, and the boy goes around in all the neighborhood and distributes sweets. So when, or if the mother might herself go, and when she comes to your door and saying, how much did your boy get? He says, 60%. 60%? Our boy got 99%. Do we need to say that? Do we need to spoil their joy? Then we say that, oh, people are not talking to us. I don't know why we are unpopular. Our Lord Jesus is great. He is teaching us the most wonderful things. And we are blind to it. We can't even see it. We teach this in communication skills in the corporate world. We teach all these things, these nuances of communication. You better be aware of it, for Jesus has taught us this. It'll be a waste if you don't read the Bible. Then Jesus says, settle matters quickly with your adversary who is taking you to court. Do it while you are still together on the way, or your adversary may hand you over to the judge, and the judge may hand you over to the officer, and you might be thrown into prison. Truly I tell you, you will not get out until you have paid the last penny. Look at our Goans now. I'm half Goan, by the way. Look at our Goans. Property. Ever since Goa became a land that was famous for tourists, property prices shot up. Then the trouble started. Every family member is fighting with each other. Every family there is a dispute. They're all gone to court and the lawyers are making merry. They don't care for you. You're feeding their children. You're educating the lawyers' children. What are you doing? Reconcile. Reconcile quickly. Don't hurt people left, right and center. Solve the problem. Some people have died and yet the court matters have not been settled. Is this the way to go? No, I don't think so. Wake up before it's too late. Wake up. Yeah, that's what Jesus is warning us. Now adultery, wow. You know, many times I used to wonder why is Jesus so harsh. When you read it in the fine print and in context of 2000 years ago, you realize the magic of this wonderful great Lord of ours. Let's see about adultery. You've heard that it was said you shall not commit adultery. But I tell you that anyone who looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart. As I said earlier, हर चीज की शुरुआत एक ख्याल से होती है. It comes into your mind, into your heart. That's why all this porn and everything, see the rise in rapes and murders of women. It all comes from there. It all comes from there. It's a sad plight. A Christian cannot afford it. He should not be there. Verse 29. If your right eye causes you to stumble, gouge it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one part of your body than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. You remember what I said last time. I showed you that thing about the temporal world and the eternal world. This temporal world is temporary. What you're working for is a place in eternity. So what Jesus, it's metaphorical, of course, what Jesus is saying. Doesn't mean you have to gouge your eyes. He is actually using exaggeration here to make his point. But honestly, have you seen the movie, a movie of Cuba Gooding Jr., where he's a scuba diver? He's an ace diver, but something happens to his foot. And he has to amputate a part of his foot. And because of that, his scuba diving is greatly affected. It slows him down. So he makes a very, very conscious decision. I'm going to amputate the whole leg so it doesn't come in the way of my work. And he gets it amputated. And if your right hand causes you to stumble, cut it off and throw it away. It's better for you to lose one part of your body than your whole body to go into hell. Now, divorce. It has been said, anyone who divorces his wife must give her a certificate of divorce. It was said, no? I think I explained to you last time also. In the previous, that's why you need to see the previous videos. It has been said, anyone who divorces his wife must give her a certificate of divorce. But I tell you that anyone who divorces his wife, except for sexual immorality, makes her the victim of adultery. And anyone who marries a divorced woman commits adultery. I told you the reason. Today's world, people say, oh, that means all divorced women are doomed. Nobody can marry them. No, Jesus didn't mean that. I'll explain this to you. You know, when I has to read this, I has to say, my word, all the divorced women are doomed. When I read the last line, and anyone who marries a divorced woman commits adultery. I'll tell you why, because you know what used to happen is, for men it was very simple, like triple talaq, you know, talaq, talaq, talaq. It was like that for the Jew. Just write a certificate of divorce and gone. The woman was out of his life. If he found something wrong with her, something, anything. But what Jesus said, anyone who divorces his wife except for sexual immorality. I told you that there was the house of Shammai and the house of Hillel. So people would take the easy way out, divorce their wives for any petty reason. The house of Hillel said, you can divorce your wife for any reason. But Shammai said, no, only for sexual immorality can you divorce her. So Jesus is saying that only for sexual immorality can you divorce your wife. Because if you divorce your wife for any other reason, you're making a victim of adultery. You know why? Because she might go and marry someone else. Your certificate of divorce which you give her is not valid in the eyes of God. And she goes and marries someone else, it is adultery against you, against the marriage, your marriage. And anyone who marries a divorced woman commits adultery. You know why? Many of these guys, you know, when a woman got married, some stranger would come and cast eyes on this woman. They would fall in love silently. And when the husband came to know that there's something going on here, he used to divorce his wife. This couple who are carrying on their silent romance, they were happy. Hare, he already gave us a divorce, gave this woman a divorce, so let us now marry. So these guys would get married then, the man, the stranger and this woman. That's why Jesus said this. If you carry on, if you fall in love with another woman, yeah, and with the intention of snatching her away from her husband, and the husband divorces her, then you are the reason for the divorce. So you have committed adultery. That's what Jesus says. A woman is already divorced for some other reason, for marital strife or domestic abuse or whatever. That woman can get married to anybody. Because some people were telling me, no, she can't get married. You can't be so orthodox, so fanatical. Let's come to the next part, oaths. Verse 33 onwards, 33 and 34 and 35. What does Jesus have to say of it? Very interesting. Again, you have heard that it was said to the people long ago, do not break your oath, but fulfill to the Lord the vows that you have made. But I tell you, in the Old Testament it was like that, but I tell you, do not swear an oath at all. Why want to use an oath? Either by heaven, for it is God's throne, or the earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. And do not swear by your head, for you cannot even make one hair white or black. All you need to say is simply yes or no. Anything beyond this comes from the evil one. Very true. In the Old Testament it is written, honor your oaths. But Jesus said, don't make oaths. Don't give oaths here, left, right and center. Don't do it. I'll tell you, when a person swears, you know, maksam, I swear on my father's head, I swear on my daughter's head. You know when they do it? When they're lying. They need to convince the person who is in front of them, because he doesn't believe them. He then says, I swear on my father's head, and I swear on my daughter's head, and I swear on my son's head. Let your yes be a yes, and your no be a no. Baat khalas. Yeah, that's the way to go. That's what Jesus is saying. Now the next verse, verse 38 and 39, are telling us something about the past. An eye for an eye. You have heard that it was said, eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. It is written. You know, they call it lex talionis. You know why? In the ancient days when humans were hunter-gatherers, you know, they had tribes that, and normally they used to live by the rivers. We need water, no, for everything, you need water. So these tribes, sometimes there used to be skirmishes between people of different tribes. They used to fight against each other. And if somebody, you know, sort of broke somebody's tooth from another tribe, this guy whose tooth was broken would go and incite the whole tribe, and the whole tribe would come and fight with this other tribe. And they used to both fight, and there'd be a lot of bloodshed and death. So they made a rule. See, listen, we don't have to conflagrate the problem. Yeah, we don't have to make it big. See, my guy broke your guy's tooth. So let him break this guy's tooth and settle the matter there and there. That was lex talionis. Okay, if he punched him in the eye or you put something inside his eye and he can't see, let your guy also do something to our guy's eye. So that was the reason why an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth came about. It's called lex talionis. You can read it in the history books. But what does Jesus say? But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. You have heard that it was said, eye for an eye and tooth for a tooth. That means you're required to take badla, no? Revenge. Jesus says, no revenge. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to them the other cheek also. This is sheer brilliance. Who can do this? It requires guts to do it. It requires terrific guts. It requires a person to be totally anchored in the eternal world, not the temporal world, where his ego and everything will fuel and fan him to get angry and take revenge. No. Then see what Jesus says in verse 40 to 42. And if anyone wants to sue you, take your shirt, hand over your coat as well. If he wants to sue you for your shirt, give him your coat also. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with them 2 miles. Give to the one who asks you and do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. Who can do this? Someone who is not attached to the world and worldly belongings. Someone who is totally rooted in the soul, not in the body. That's why Jesus is saying this. Think about it. To reach this stage, this is very difficult, but it is possible if you are in grace. All the generous people in the world are like this. Then you wonder why Bill Gates has given all his, bequeathed all his wealth to the world. How his philanthropic institutions are working even in UP, Bihar, all over the world. How Warren Buffett, you know, a simple man with simple needs, has donated everything. Next is love for enemies. By the way, as I said earlier in last Wednesday, I told you that when give the other cheek doesn't mean for the others, it means for you. Suppose somebody, one of your friends is getting hammered, don't tell him that you give the other cheek. You go and defend him, take care of him, because maybe he's right and he's being bullied by somebody. Take care of him. Now we come to the next part, love for enemies. You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. It is said that. Love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven, that you may be like God. How? God causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good. He sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. Don't you know that? God doesn't put his sunshine only on good people. He says, sabko. Sabko mera sunshine. Sabke liye mera rain. Everybody will get my rain. He doesn't differentiate. That is true agape love. You remember agape I have taught? I hope you watched my earlier videos. Again, can I remind you? Sorry. You can see, even a snake loves its pillows. Even the worst killer, murderer loves his own children. He knows how to love his own children. But that type of love is not love. We got storge and we got philia. Then we got eros, the sexual type of love. No, we are talking of the agape love. The agape love that looks at everybody as if they are looking at God, they are looking at Jesus. They love everybody. The day you start learning that, you are in heaven. If you love those who love you, that's verse 46 onwards. If you love those who love you, what reward would you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Do not even pagans do that? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. Tell me, isn't it wonderful? Jesus is showing us the way. He is truly the way, the truth, and the life. This ends chapter 5. You got 6 and 7. And it's so wondrous. The Sermon on the Mount is truly the greatest sermon ever. It is our roadmap to eternal life. It is our roadmap to heaven. And to summarize the sermon, what summary of whatever we've done in the last two sessions, you have to read chapter 5 by yourself, and the Holy Spirit will bless you with more insights. That will be the best way to summarize. And if you've not yet subscribed, please subscribe. That's all for today, folks. Until next Wednesday, 7 p.m. God bless and praise God.